After the events of Disgaea 4, it became a little bit too obvious that politics have absolutely no place in demon society. Carnage. Absolute destruction rained down on the entire universe, and in its wake, thousands of netherworlds crumbled, unable to withstand the power of a dreaded evil that even demons wince at the sight of. Inflation. Now back in my day on Veldheim, you could afford just about everything on the market at just a few hundred levels in, if even that. Now judges want billions of dollars just to pass bills.
Broke nigga alert! Broke nigga alert! Broke nigga alert!
The system is corrupt, vile, and inhuman. I mean, they are demons, but I think that there's something to be said about the system when even though the schools are mass brainwashing the children that aren't even attending their classes, they still think that politicians are the worst form of scum. Enter Disgaea 5, a game that isn't really about anything. It's a story about revenge, but you never really get revenge on anyone. It's a story about loss, but hey, I mean, even the story doesn't seem to care about that one. It's a story where trillions of people are dying, but I still can't find a single person who cares. I'm just here for the gameplay. And any child lost in the carnage is not really my fault. It's just the natural cycle of things. So, what's the gameplay like? Well, it's a strategy RPG where balance is completely thrown out the window, and the animations show. Black holes decimate solar systems just so that you can cause an explosion that levels the field. You put on a big ass sword just so that you can crucify your enemies, and you absorb the moon and wait, what the fuck? Assemble a squad and make cool ass combinations to win battles. The level of freedom here is unmatched by other games in the series, and that's in part due to how much has changed. Speaking of changes, weapon mastery is back, baby, that's right. And it's not just for weapons this time, it's for armor as well. And, you know, it's actually kind of underwhelming compared to how it was in Disgaea 2. But, hey, it's an excellent start. Let's see, skills weren't handled by somebody who's never played the series before, so, yeah, there's that. Magic requires a degree of effort to get it running, and, basically the game is just fucking good. There's no caveat like there was with Disgaea 4 where I tell you that the game sucks for, you know, about 30 to 40 hours of playtime. It's just good, and even more so than good.
You're gonna shoot! And that's a promise. That's a promise, folks.
You're constantly unlocking new things, while the path to unlocking the stuff that you might not even know that you want is very clear and laid out by the new quest system that they added. Even better is that class unlocking is delegated to class mastery now, which is something that anyone can get. Meaning that you can unlock classes by leveling up the units that you actually want to instead of painstakingly leveling up each class individually, regardless of whether or not you have any interest in actually using them. It's natural, enjoyable, and better yet, actually benefits whatever character you're doing it on. I think that the pre-post game is my favorite out of the whole series, and honestly, it's where I had the most fun, and why I would recommend this game if you're looking to get into the series. I know that I talk a lot about post-game content in my reviews, and I feel like I'm explaining Yu-Gi-Oh card effects while everyone wants to just play Uno. So I suppose that now would be a good of time as any to actually talk about how to play the game. So, first things first, you're going to want to familiarize yourself with the triangle button. If you're playing on Switch, that's probably the X button. We're just going to start a new game, and that's really all you need to know. For the most part, this plays like a standard strategy RPG. You can move your characters on a grid, and you can attack. And when I say attack, what I really mean is send your unit in there and make him mercilessly beat your opponent until he starts convulsing on the floor. Disgaea gameplay is a lot like being in Detroit. You gotta shoot to kill and hope that his friends aren't around. Regular attacks are fine, sure, but I mean, we're trying to replicate some real Russian quality stuff, and these guys keep getting back up. You're gonna want something with a little bit more stopping power. That's where skills come in. They vary from Light Tickle to Kamen Rider. And if you're feeling frisky, they added a revenge gauge into the game. Story units, which I'm just gonna call uniques, have special powers called overloads, and later on even generics will get to use these. They're pretty cool, but pale in comparison to the real breadwinner here. Some absolute madman decided to implement the most busted skill in the game and make it so that any character can use it, squad attack. Now, sometimes it does nothing. Other times I feel like they're about to give me a Nobel Peace Prize for ordering a drone strike in the Middle East. The roster is great. It's got an assortment of good characters, including my favorite new unit, the Armor Knight. If she's defending and not within the range of an attack, she can swap out with another unit. Also new is the Sage, which is just a testament to how fucked we are as a society. No one even looked at this class when it was just an old man, but you give it the Bomberman treatment and everyone's creaming themselves. Now everyone has a Sage, thanks in part to the fact that it's the only class in the entire game that can consistently hit every unit on the map, which is vital for clearing item world maps for post-game progression. This is just Nippon Ichi's way of getting revenge for nobody using the class preceding it. Now everyone has to use it. The rest of the units are pretty great too. There's an assortment of good unique abilities, and the system has been greatly expanded now. Taking some not-so-subtle notes from Disgaea D2, you can grab other classes' abilities, and each class has multiple unique abilities on top of their already unique skill sets. It allows for a lot of customization, and the system has a lot of potential, especially because even though you only start with one ability slot, eventually it can be expanded to four. There's also a completely separate system for common abilities. Honestly, it's the best customization in the series, and I'm not just saying that because you can give the main character blackface. There are some problems, but those only really surface once you start optimizing for the postgame. So far, I have more or less covered the basics. As for the more advanced gameplay, it's pretty intense. Every time that you think that you're done, it just keeps going. There's always something new to do. God, I just love this fucking game. Honestly, there's a lot that we're not going to talk about, such as this shit right here. I just want to talk about Item World, because to be quite honest, this shit right here is where Disgaea 5 both succeeds and creates a massive issue for the postgame. The Item World is kind of like a dungeon composed of randomized maps. Now, in Disgaea 4, it was really simple. Kind of a joke, even. You had two separate paths to pick from, and a maximum of 100 floors, and if I'm being completely honest, you really were only going to pick one of those paths. It was really hard to fuck up your gear, but you still could. You also skipped every single floor, and there was basically no challenge. Then you just mass-produced all your hard work. So what did they do to make Item World interesting? They made a bunch of different viable paths, made innocence actually worth something, made cloning harder, and then on top of it, made it a fucking nightmare to actually stroll through. Half the time I'm not grinding just so that I can do the story or so that I can do some interesting challenge. No, it's to survive this shit. This shit is harsh. It's pretty easy to just leave, but there's always a constant pushback from the enemies when you're trying to get better items. I just want to kick back and enjoy Item World, but I have to do all this other shit just so that I can survive. It's part of the reason why the early to mid game is the best part. Everything else in the postgame is really easy, but I feel like I've gotten All Lives Matter sign in a melanin-enriched neighborhood while I'm in the Item World. And unfortunately, that's where the problems start to come in. See, I have a bunch of shit that I have to grind out, and it becomes much harder than it has to be when you have no idea how to get into it. This game has a lot of customization, too much customization really, and a lot of it comes from DLC characters.
It's bondage gay website, it's all male.
Now, I have these DLC characters since I have the complete version of the game, however there's a lot getting in the way of figuring things out for myself, such as massive translation errors that make it impossible to know what the hell some of these abilities actually do. So, for some reason, we have these massive attack modifiers translated as ATK, which is also what they use to refer to the attack stat. What this does, on most abilities, is that it boosts your damage modifiers by a certain percent before defenses are calculated in. To give you an idea as to why this is an issue, I can comfortably triple my damage modifier with any character using these setups, even more if I feel like screwing around. Not only are these abilities just sort of lying about somewhere, even if I were to find one of them, I would have to do some testing to even know if they had anything to do with the attack stat or this damage modifier. Again, this happens before calculation, so in reality, I'm not just tripling damage, sometimes I'm doing several times over. It's impossible to know how much this is on a case-to-case basis, but I've gone from 5% of the health bar to Nagasaki. Even worse is that this isn't all that they fucked up on. There are multiple abilities in the game where it just doesn't do anything remotely close to what it says it does. And as such, I will be providing a post that I stumble across talking about useful abilities in the description, as well as a list of abilities with translation errors. I imagine that the screwy translation made a lot of players feel that the options were less complex than they actually are, as there's only really so much that you can do when the game has so many strong as hell abilities, but their function is just poorly communicated. Again, I just have to drill it into you that customization is the best that it's ever been in the series, and when I initially wrote that line in the script, I didn't even know about all this because I only really remembered this about 150 hours into the game. And once I found out about how amazing these abilities are, it made me just love the game even more. and only after figuring everything out was I sort of prepared for the dicking that is the item world in postgame, but not really, because this shit still beats me like I owed money. It's about at this point that I'm starting to really miss the early to mid game. As cool as it is to make a gigantic tower that slams enemies in the nuts, it's starting to get to me. I feel like I'm missing something. Something important. Ah, fuck, I forgot to talk about geopanels again, didn't I? Third review in the series is as good a time as any to talk about geopanels. This shit is rampant in the item world, and honestly, that's where it's the best. Basically, the way that it works is that some levels will just have geopanels on them, and if a geosymbol is on one of these panels, any panel of the same color gets its effect. I've always loved these things, but sometimes in past games, the level generation can fuck you up by spawning shit like invincibility and no lifting symbols everywhere. Destroying a geosymbol while it's on a panel will change its color, causing a chain if it hits another geosymbol in the process. And if a clear geosymbol is triggered, it will erase the panels. And if it clears every panel off the field, it causes a massive explosion. And my god, do I just love to see it. It has such a good feeling to it, and even though there's virtually no reward, I'd still stop to do them from time to time in other games. Geopuzzles are especially great here though, as they provide a way to get item level ups in the early game. It's something that I'd love to see expanded on, preferably with unique rewards for the item that I'm diving into that don't just become completely irrelevant down the line. Something other than just levels, you know? Especially since getting kill bonuses and stuff like that is a pain in the ass. I'd also love to see them appear more in story maps, because they're rarely satisfying to solve. Most of the time, they're used just to make me hate the level design and pad out the game in annoying ways. Especially in Disgaea 4. There's a moment in Disgaea 2 where they have a geo setup similar to how it would be in the item world. And the first time that I did the level, I ignored Nidel entirely, thinking that he got the answer wrong. I mean, it was the first time that they'd ever shown him to be smart, so I just tried to solve the puzzle for myself. And really, I just want more levels like that. Speaking of the story, I kind of skipped over that. Right off the bat, we're thrown into a battle between the secret third Columbine shooter and the Lost, some losers that are conquering everything. And this is where we run into the first problem. I just don't fucking care.
You are mine, Sir Kilia. Please, do not resist.
Shut the fuck up! I don't know, I'm supposed to care, I guess, but you know, you're supposed to set up a motive or something for why we're fighting these guys. And I mean, okay, they're conquering the universe, I guess. It's just so damn lazy of an entrance. The villain is actually cool and an asshole, but for a majority of the story, we're not even going to interact with him. I mean, I want to see the main character's motives, I want to see why he's fighting, and yet, we only really get a proper explanation as the game is on its last few chapters. Compare this to Disgaea 2, where the motive is clear and justified from the instant that you start the game. You know why Adele fights, it's for his family and friends. You're introduced to them immediately too, so as to give you a stake in the action.
Is your family missing? Think about it.
Which can make things more tense when you know that something is actually on the line, and you know that while he wants to fight these strong as hell demons, he doesn't quite have the power yet. Even in the other games where the game can start talking about
horse wiener,
I can at least have a laugh. But why should I care about the main character's dead girlfriend? She's the worst kind of motivation they could have gone with. She's dead, so we can't even interact with her, and the game just flashes pictures of her on the screen like this is Dead Rising. Everyone keeps saying that the main character is edgy, but if he was, I'd actually like him. He wants revenge, but all it amounts to is him talking to himself. And the reason winds up bleeding into what would have otherwise been my favorite character, Void Dark. They waste so much time setting up each character to develop them, and it's a nice gesture, but it puts the story at a complete halt, since every character has to have their own arc. The story is ultimately nothing new, but it would have been nice if they let it breathe and develop. You have to put some effort into this sort of thing, especially if you want to reuse ideas. But instead, it's just retreaded territory that borrows from the last three games without adding anything that made them good. It's such a shitty rehash, too. If you want to motivate me to play the game, just make the villain kill my dog or something, I don't know. The revenge plot feels more like they just wanted an excuse to use the revenge mechanic. I swear to god, if I find another anime game where the main character looks dead ass into the fucking camera with a shit-eating grin and says, "Well, I guess the real revenge was the friends we all made along the way," I'm gonna Mitsuyasu Maeno some fucking headquarters. But hey, I've been hard on this game, mostly because I know that a lot of people don't even give the gameplay a shot when they see the first few chapters. Despite my criticisms, I actually enjoyed the story my first time through. It's got a lot of character development, and these characters, they've found a place in my heart, and you know, absolutely nothing could ruin that. Usually, I'd give a warning about showing parts of the ending. Most people don't like to be spoiled on a game that they're trying to figure out if they should play, but it's the final chapter, and they're finally going to explain what Void Dark's motivation is. And, you know, he's my favorite character, and the plot is actually really strong right now. Main characters died leading up to this, so you know that they're going to treat my investment with the respect that it deserves.
But, Killia, I need you to listen to me, and do me one final favor. Please, help my sister to bring back my sister. To bring back her
smile.
Wait,
what? Are you fucking serious?
A ridiculous amount of energy.
I'm not sure I like where Nintendo is taking this remake of Fire Emblem 4.
It's about a brother and a sister. That. Fuck.
Jesus Christ, Nipponichi is really writing the book on how to spit in the player's face right now. Imagine with me for a moment. We're at the end of Final Fantasy VII, right? Classic game with a memorable plot. You're right before the final confrontation with Sephiroth, and Cloud asks him point blank, "Alright man, why'd you do it?" "Well, I just always wanted to fuck my mom." You'd be fucking pissed. Then Advent Children happens, then fucking Remake happens, and it's not a remake at all. Believe me, that this comparison is very apt, because the plot keeps going after the story ends. It's like they're pouring salt into my wounds in real time, waiting for me to stop playing, but they know that I have to keep going to unlock everything. So enough about the plot. I don't play these games for the plot, unless it's the first two games. I just find myself constantly finding excuses to play this game, and now here I am struggling to get this video out because I'm 170 hours in and loving it. I know that I might have started to scare some of you talking about how Item World is hard as hell. Don't worry too much. It gets better. Kind of like how things got better after 9/11. Don't be sad that it's over. Be happy that it happened. I heard that we got some really sick dance moves out of it. There's really only two things worth talking about from here on. The fact that and that I have to fight Void Dark again, which goes over about as well as you might think.
Hypothetical self-defense scenario.
Peacekeeper.
You're coming at me in a dark alleyway, you've got some sort of weapon, you're enraged, eating gallons of ice cream, stuffing rocks in yourself, but I don't have time to bed you. I don't have time to fuck you calm. I didn't want it to be like this.
Not too long after that, you get a fight Ball, and then the game is basically over. For the most part, the first 100 hours are the best in the series. It's a good game, so don't let my criticisms deter you from checking it out. This may very well be my last review on the series, as I don't feel that Disgaea 1 warrants its own review, as even though the story is pretty enjoyable, the gameplay feels a little bit too bare bones to me. It doesn't help that whenever I recommend the series to someone, they typically start with Disgaea 1 and then never finish it. As for Disgaea 3 and D2, they're console locked, and I lack the equipment to record them. I'm also worried that I can only make these videos so entertaining. Only so much changes with each entry, so for the time being, that's gonna be all. I appreciate you all for sticking by and watching through to the end, and I hope that you have a good one. Oh, as a closing note, if you're curious as to what I thought about Disgaea 6, well...
Let rice cooker handle the cooking. Now you have time to think about your sad life. Why do the people you love always leave you? Oh, now rice is ready.